We're on.
And square and move.
Yes, we can.
Okay.
Awesome.
I might as well look at the names. That'd be 202 downstairs. This coming Friday, we'll be setting up for the donation only yard sale at 5:30. Anyone's able to come help set up for that. Food will be provided. Saturday is the donation only yard sale starting at 8 a.m. Next Sunday, class 101 at 9:30 in service at 11. There are vegetables downstairs, so help yourself. Thank you, Paul and Leslie. There's a new volunteer calendar in the back, so be sure to grab one of those. And if you'd like to help volunteer, talk to Frankie. If you have any questions about baptism, also talk to Frankie. If you're interested in helping middle and high school teenagers come to Christ through Young Life Ministries, talk to Dean, that's me. Then there's going to be a meeting on September 14th after the well. For anyone interested in being helping out with Young Life Ministries. The last community bonfire for the summer will be September 15th at 6 p.m. Bring a chair and food to share. Hot dogs and s'mores will be provided. Men's and women's small groups will be beginning September 21st. We'll be meeting on Thursdays at 6:30, except for the second Thursday, which is the well. Then we'll meet September 14th at 6:30 in Colebrook. Please join us for our last outdoor well until next summer. Burgers and hot dogs will be provided. Bring something to share. And the restrooms are downstairs, and there's hot drinks in the back. Are there any other announcements?
Yeah. Just about the men's and women's group. So we decided to do it on the same night so that everyone can have their own thing, and then childcare will be provided, and I can put that in there. So if you have any questions, women, you can talk to me. Men can talk to Frankie or Dean. I'm really excited. So come see me and we can chat about it. And locations to be determined. We're still figuring that out.
Dean, I just have to say, Ed and I were talking about setting up Friday. Mm-hmm. And we'd rather do it a little earlier than 5:30.
Okay.
If people can.
Frankie and Katie are not going to be here on Friday, so if we can get as many people over here to help us set up for the tax sale, it would be appreciated.
We're dropping our child off at college, so yeah.
Pray for them.
So like, what time are you thinking, guys? Like,
probably early afternoon. 12:30, 1 o'clock, I'll probably be here.
12:30, 1 o'clock on Friday to help to start setting up. Any other announcements? Okay, we can read scripture together.
Though the fig tree does not bud and there are no grapes on the vines,
but the olive grows and the field produces no food.
Though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls,
then I will rejoice in the Lord.
find my Savior. It's hard to read.
Good morning, beautiful people. So, this is an interesting scripture, and Katie's like, why would you even put this up there? Well, we're talking about Habakkuk today, and Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 6 through 7 says this: "Will not all of them taunt him with ridicule and scorn, saying, 'Woe to him who piles up stolen goods and makes himself wealthy by extortion'? How long must this go on? Will not your creditors suddenly arise? Will they not wake up and make you tremble? Then you will become their prey." How many people are in debt? Yeah, don't get your hand. Yeah. And so a lot of times the people that we're in debt to kind of want the money now. Or they'll charge you 24%, 38% on that if you're late. And they'll come after you. They'll ruin your life. And so we should be more indebted in Jesus and to give our talents and our time, because Jesus isn't coming for that. Because if our heart is in the right place, we already are with him and we're already giving back. But be careful where you put your debt. It should be in Jesus and in your time and talents and sharing with other people, rather than trying to get all the money in the world and then they come after you anyway. So wise words from Habakkuk. So if you'd like to give, there's a link on Facebook. There's a plate back there in the back. And then if you want to volunteer with your time or your talent, that would be great. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Are there any prayer requests?
Yes. Pray for the whole world.
And true. The whole world. Leslie?
You have to see it. My neighbor, Barbara, she's in the hospital. They need us. For unity and not division.
Mm-hmm. If there's one thing that Satan likes, it's division.
Men's and women's Bible studies.
Anything else? I'm also Betty George. Did I say that right, George? But Betty, Leah's friend, has cancer. And pray for Katie and I that we have wisdom. There's some stuff coming up that we need to have God's wisdom.
Noise family, keep them in our prayers, and
yes.
Dean's family
has passed
as well.
There's been a lot of deaths around us. Marna and also Dean's aunt. Marna. Yeah, Martha. Thank you.
Prefer schools.
Yeah, school starts Tuesday. And pray for Ellie and Andrew off to college on September 1st. So. Yes?
My sister is going in for surgery for a mass that's in front of her thyroid.
Anything else? All right. If not, let's go to God's prayer. God, sometimes it's hard to pray, all the
things that are happening around us, beating us up and putting us down. God, we come to you, we run to you as a stronghold, as you lift us up. And God, I pray that you will help us to understand that Satan's right behind the corner of everything. But in the name of Jesus, we have power by the Holy Spirit, and to encourage one another and to equip them for good works. God, you never said it was going to be easy. But God, you said there is a way out when we're tempted. God, you have given us power. You have given us the fruit of the Spirit. You've given us everything to be prepared to put on our armor and to take up our cross daily. Even if it hurts, God, we need to still walk with you and talk with you and love you and to love others. That we may forgive and put it on our hearts to forgive and to stop some of the things that we're saying out of our mouth, that we may bring it to your throne and leave it there. God, I pray that our health will be in your sight, especially some of these operations cancer that people are suffering. And God, we don't understand, but we want to bring it to you and to trust you. We know that Betty is going through some hard times with that, and also Patsy, and we know a lot of people who are suffering from that, especially passing away of a couple people who have suffered with illness and cancer. God, I pray for their families to be comforted. We know that there's hope and after we pass away with Jesus. And I pray that everyone will have that opportunity to come and to know you better. God, I pray for the upcoming Bible studies and the people who are running them, that they may give them wisdom and understanding. And God, it's good for me to sit in the audience and to be ministered to. And I pray that I can grow in my faith as those around me will grow in theirs. God, thank you so much for your love and mercy. And I pray for the whole world. It's gone crazy. But we know the answer is through Jesus. And God, we know we preach a simple gospel. And I pray that people will accept it and don't complicate it. You are not the God of confusion, but you are the God who loves us and has taken care of us and has brought us thus far. God, I pray for Barbara in the hospital and the doctors may help her. We pray for our churches and our people that are in them, that we may be unified and we may kick Satan out of the things that we're going through, through Jesus' name and the power that you've given us. God, I pray that you will help us to not be divided, that we may come together under you, and knowing that we're all at fault at something, that all sin is the same, and God, that we may be forgiven. If we're forgiven much, then we can forgive others. And God, I pray that we will put that on our hearts. We thank you for those who have attended and those who are watching on live, and those who watch after. I pray for them to be blessed, and families who are going through some trouble today. I've heard a couple of them, and God, I pray that you know what they're going through and that you may answer with comfort and understanding. God, we thank you so much for answering our prayers. You don't have to do anything, and we are so joyful that you are mindful of us and that you answer according to your will, not ours. I pray that we would trust in that. That we don't trust in our understanding of things, and that we may know that we can give it to you and then walk away from it, because you know all, you are in our lives, and I pray that you will help us to walk faithfully with you and to always love you more. We thank you for letting us serve. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together. Everyone's going to hear it.
Thank you.
predictions for things or this earth or people or how we want to see things. God, open our eyes to your grace and mercy, and we can share that to others. We thank you for your amazing grace. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Save a wretch like me.
sing a joyful noise to you. No matter if we mess up or not, God, we're singing to you, and you are forgiving and wonderful. Thank you for letting us use our talents, even though we sang these songs over and over again. God, we want to know the words, and we want to grow deeper in you. No matter what we're suffering or going through, God, you are still wonderful, majestic, and holy, and righteous. Let the Spirit open our minds and our hearts that we know your truth, and we may be set free, and that we may grow in our faith as we act more like you and not ourselves. And God, thank you for letting us take up our cross daily and to suffer in your name. We just love you and thank you. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
You may have a seat. Kindergarten through fifth grade, you go downstairs with Katie. So we're going through the books of the Bible and finding that Jesus is in every one of them. And so we started out with Genesis and we're going all the way to Revelation. But today we're going to a book that not many people read. And his name is kind of weird. Habakkuk. Everybody say Habakkuk.
Habakkuk.
Exactly. It's like the stuttering prophet. Habakkuk. Anyway. I'm not making fun of stuttering people because I have two of them in my family. But it's kind of cool name. Habakkuk points to Jesus as a watchman. Now, we're not talking about watches. They didn't have watches back then. Okay, we're talking about a watchman that is on the parapet or the wall and seeing what is happening before it gets there. He's the one who warns people before enemies come, or if there's a good news, he tells them the good news before it hits the wall. And so, God's timing is everything. When we are in the mess of things, or when we are looking at good things, we don't understand God's timing. Now, we trust in his timing, we trust in what he is doing, but his timing is way off than ours. Since he created everything, and he is, God who doesn't go like, oh, it's 11:39, you better hurry up, Frankie. They got to eat, you know. Don't go late. God doesn't do that. He's neither late nor early. He's always on time. He's always with us. And he's always present. And it's his time, because a lot of times we want it what?
Now.
We want it now. What was that commercial? Jay Wentworth. I want my money now. Anyway, commercials, too many of them. So, it's all in God's timing. So, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9 says this. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. We see things happen only in our perspective. But there is a spiritual war. There is a spiritual timing. There is a spiritual world that we cannot see. And we know it exists because evil exists, good exists. We know that there is a war and a battle within us to do the right thing at the right time. And so as we acknowledge that God has timing that is not on our time, we bring things to him. And so Habakkuk actually brings his struggles and his complaints. He'll go, we can't complain to God. Actually, that's the one person we need to complain to, because he has everything in his hands. And he will answer. If you read the whole book of Job, Job complains a lot to God and asks him and questions him. But what does God say about Job? He never sinned in what he said. Because he complained to God, he never lost his faith in those complaints. But he waited on God, and God answered him. And then we think of struggle in this world. Why is evil so rampant? Why is there so much oppression and hurt and pain and sickness? And Habakkuk actually, the book of Habakkuk actually answers that. Habakkuk chapter 1 verse 2, here's Habakkuk's first complaint. How long, Lord, must I call for help, and you do not listen? Or cry out to you, violence, but you do not save? You're like, whoa. You just questioned God. Yeah, he has broad shoulders. Okay? It's okay to do that, but not to lose your faith in it. You think that God would strike down Habakkuk the first sentence, right down because he's complaining, but God doesn't. Why? Because we want to find our answers in God. God said he wants to hear from us, all of it. The bad, the good, the ugly, the complaints, the grumbles. We want everything to go to God. Every facet of our spiritual life should not be hidden in the presence of God, even if it hurts. Even if we don't get an answer right away, or our trust and our faith is put in God. When we complain to God, we ask him for wisdom to fix it. And let his will be done, not ours. We run to God for everything. And it's not a crutch. People are like, well, you know, it's a crutch in your life. No, it actually takes a lot more strength to believe in God and to actually say, it's not me, it's you. Instead of saying, I have all the answers. I don't have all the answers, so please do not come to church because of me. Come to church because we are together and trying to find God's grace and forgiveness and love and understanding together. All of us in this room are sinners in the hands of a loving God. No one sin is above another. Even Habakkuk sinned, but he did not sin as he questioned God. And the cool thing is, the Lord answered him. Not only did God hear the complaint and not strike him dead, but then he actually answers Habakkuk. Look at verse 5. Look at the nations and watch and be utterly amazed. For I am going to do something, this is God talking, for I am going to do something in your days that you would not believe even if you were told. See, Jesus is watching us. Jesus is the watchman on the tower, watching for the things coming and going and watching us in the kingdom, in the stronghold. And we talked about that. He does things that no one has ever thought of. Can you ever think of a baby in a manger, nasty feeding trough, coming to be the king of the world? Nobody would have ever. Even if it was told to us that there was going to be a baby in a manger born from a virgin who was a sinner just like all of us, and he lived a life and grew up as a kid, he didn't grow up in a palace or a rich palace or on a white horse coming in to save us. He grew up in the nasty part of and a little town in Bethlehem. If he would have told us that before it happened, he would have like, no. If we're going to have the king of the universe come here, he's going to be in palaces, he's going to have crowns, he's going to have glory, there's not going to be any evil on the earth, he's going to take away everything. And then he comes with a spiritual kingdom that we can't see. And here's Habakkuk's answer. Look, I'm going to do something that even if you were told, you probably wouldn't believe anyway. And he's talking about he's going to use the enemies to come judge Israel, and then Israel is going to destroy that enemy. Now, if you would have told Israel at that time, they'd be like, you're crazy. There's no way. Blasphemy. Get out. But God did it. And God is amazing. There are so many things in our life that we look back, you know, hindsight is 20/20. We look back and like, wait a minute, God did that. That could have never happened if it wasn't for God. Well, and then we get older and older and we keep looking back and we're like, okay, our whole life could have not happened if it wasn't for God. We would not be breathing or having food or clothing or a building or even walking with our feet or our eyeballs. It's the amazing God who holds that all together. Now we just don't think about it. We don't thank him for everything. And here's Habakkuk. Oh, wow, I got the answer. I'm going to complain again. Isn't that funny that even us humans do that? We get the answer from God, like, oh, I didn't like that one. I'm going to pray this and see if you answer this one. Or, wow, that was great. Maybe I'll do it again and I'll get the same result. It's God's time. Habakkuk's second complaint. Habakkuk 1, 12 through 13. Lord, are you not from everlasting? My God, my Holy One, you will never die. You, Lord, have appointed them to execute judgment of the enemies. You, my rock, have ordained them to punish. Your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrongdoing. Why then do you tolerate the treacherous? Wow, that's a pretty poignant question. Why are you silent while the wicked swallow up those more righteous than themselves? Now, why is there evil? Why are people suffering? Why is this happening? God might be silent to our audible ears, but he is never silent. God moves all the time. We do not know his timing because we only can see our finite timing. We do not know his eyes since we can't see the past, the present, or the future. We do not know the plan since his plans are holy, righteous, loving, and our definition is not right or holy or loving. So Habakkuk complains, but he trusts. And so he has these two complaints out there. God, why is this happening? Don't we say that question? Even the strongest Christians say, why, God, am I going through this? And we cry. We're snot filled on the floor. And it hurts. And it brings us to our knees. We can either be bitter or we can be better. Habakkuk becomes better here in the end. But Jesus still has an answer for him. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 1. This is Habakkuk saying, I will climb my watchtower and wait to see what the Lord will tell me to say and what answer he will give to my complaint. We pray and then we wait. We don't say pray and then, come on, God, hurry up. Come on. I got it. You're late. God doesn't have time like us. He moves in a way to bring people closer to him. It could be in suffering. It could be in a great day. It could be in not getting persecuted at all. It could be in being persecuted all your life. It could be a pain that's in your side all your life. Like Paul said, you know, I have this thorn in my side, but God, I prayed to you 3 times to take it away, and God said, no. I think it humbled Paul. Habakkuk's here saying, look, there's evil in the world, there's treachery, there's these things that are happening. What are you doing? And so he climbs the watchtower, and he says, I'll sit and wait. Isn't that the hardest thing with humans? I don't like. I mean, that's why I have a cell phone, right? That's why I have a computer. That's why I have the internet. Because you can get answers what? Like it says, if you look up in Google, when you go to Google, and you look something up, right at the bottom of your search thing, it says how many seconds it took to get this many millions of web pages to answer your question. It's like 0.0003 seconds or something. It's crazy. I remember when the time when, you had to look at the newspaper, and it was a week old anyway. Or you had to watch black and white TV with a little button of color. You know? Or you had to put your finger on the antenna and you had to stand there, you know, as a child. And Dad's like, okay, put your finger over here. Oh, got it. There's the news. And I would stand there until the news stopped, okay? But we got instantaneous answers. And we expect that of God. Don't. It is his timing. He is wise. He is awesome. But we should wait. Because if we do it, it's going to be messed up. If we push the issue, it's going to be messed up. So here's the Lord's answer to Habakkuk's second complaint. Woe to him who builds, Habakkuk chapter 2, 12 through 14. Woe to him who builds a city with bloodshed and establishes a town by injustice. Guys, evil doesn't pass by God's eyes without being acknowledged as evil. You know that, right? And he'll let things go on so your enemy will repent. He doesn't want the enemies to die, the ones who are hurting you, and he doesn't want you to die in your sin either. He wants both of them to come to heaven. And so he'll wait. He'll be patient. But he'll get angry. God will get angry. Look at verse 13. Has not the Lord Almighty determined that the people labor is only fuel for the fire, that the nations exhaust themselves for nothing? For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Just because God uses nations of evil and people do evil things doesn't discredit God. He has given us choice, and that choice can be turned to evil. Our choices of what we eat or what we look at or what we see or what we do with our bodies has results. Our gene pool is getting worse and worse. Now, scientists won't say that. They think we're getting better and better. Have you looked at all the medicine we have now? Have you looked at our bodies? Have you looked since the dawn of time and how worse we're getting? Unless we have Jesus, evil will keep going. We need Jesus in every part of life. And here's Habakkuk getting the answer. Look, woe to him who builds on the city of bloodshed, because they will come down someday. But we must wait. It's not that God says, okay, that's good, and keep going with evil. No, he's given them a chance to come back. Our job is to love our enemies and to praise God for our persecution. The church grows when we are persecuted. And so Habakkuk comes around and he prays. Isn't that interesting? He has two complaints. God answers them twice. And then Habakkuk waits and he prays. What's our first thought when somebody comes after us? It's not to pray. I know that much. What's the first thing when somebody gossips about you or hurts you or doesn't forgive you or says horrible things or starts beating you up or starts persecuting you? What's our first reaction as humans? I'm coming back after you, buddy. Habakkuk steps back. He waits as a watchman and prays. If we would just pray more before we said it. If we would have just prayed more than to try to fix it ourselves. If we would have just prayed and stopped and acknowledged God's glory and holiness before we did something, life would be better. Life would be better for me. Because sometimes I just jump in. I feel like I jump in front of the train and I get run over and I'm like, oh yeah, God, you should have been acknowledged first. And I feel horrible. And then God reveals himself and says, I love you. Come back to me. So Habakkuk prays. This is an awesome prayer. I'm not even going to go in discussion on the prayer. I'm just going to read it to you. I wish we would pray like this more. A prayer of Habakkuk the prophet on Shinnikoth, which is a term for music. Lord, I have heard of your fame. I stand in awe of your deeds, Lord, repeat them in our day. In our time, make them known. In wrath, remember mercy. God came from Teman, the Holy One, from Mount Paran. His glory covered the heavens and his praise filled the earth. His splendor was like that of the sunrise. Rays flashed from his hand where his power was hidden. Plague went before him. Pestilence followed his steps. He stood and shook the earth. He looked and made the nations tremble. The ancient mountains crumble and the age-old hills collapse, but he marches on forever. I saw the tents of Cushan in distress and the dwellings of Midian in anguish. Were you angry with the rivers, Lord? Was your wrath against the streams? Did you rage against the sea when you rode your horses and your chariots to victory? You uncovered your bow. You called for many arrows. You split the earth with rivers. The mountains saw you and writhed. Torrents of water swept by. The deep roared and lifted the waves on high. Sun and moon stood still in the heavens in the glint of your flying arrows, at the lightning of your flashing spear. In wrath, you strode through the earth, and in anger, you threshed the nations. You came out to deliver your people, to save your anointed one. You crushed the leader of the land of wickedness. You stripped him from head to foot. With his own spear, you pierced his head, with his warriors stormed out to scatter us, gloating as they though about to devour the wretched who were in hiding. You trampled the sea with your horses, churned the great waters. I heard and my heart pounded. My lips quivered at the sound. Decay crept into my bones and my legs trembled. Yet I will wait patiently for the day of calamity to come on the nation of Israel. For the fig tree does not bud and there are no grapes on the vines, for the olive crop fails and the field produces no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet, what does it say? I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. The Sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to tread on heights for the director of music on my string instrument. He played guitar. Even if your prayer is not answered right away, or God says no, or you're hurting and you're in pain and evils are all around you, God is still on his throne. We should be joyful in God my Savior, no matter what happens. Why is evil here and why are we suffering? Because sin and the fall of man. Nature is crying out to God to come back because it's sinful. Our bodies are dying because of sin in this world. Death was not normal. We should never die. But because of sin and decay, we do. What can we do about it? Trust in God's timing, wisdom, and pray for our enemies. Where can we complain and run to? Jesus. Sunday school answer people. What can we do to give hope and mature in our faith? Forgive, love, praise God in our good times and bad times, and know that Jesus is waiting for us to come in. Even our enemies get grace. Because no one should suffer hell. Not even our enemies. You know how hard that is? To acknowledge and forgive? But listen to this again, 2 Peter 3:9. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understood slowness. Instead, he is what? Patient with you. Not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. And that word everyone means who? Everyone. Even the people that hurt you. Even the people that are evil. He wants everyone to come to repentance. We need to pray like Habakkuk. Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails, and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen, and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God, my Savior. Jesus is the watchman. He is watching over us. 100%. Do we feel it sometimes? No. Do we see it sometimes? No. But that doesn't mean that Jesus left us. He loves us. He comforts us in his timing, not ours. Trust in him more. Pray. And he will answer. God, thank you for Habakkuk. Thank you for letting him be a prophet and prophesying that no matter what evil is in the world, no matter if we're oppressed or hurt, you are still in control. We still rejoice in your word. We still forgive others. Help us to wait. To be silent in your presence. And to know that you are God and we are not. Help us to acknowledge that. If there's any wicked way in us, let it come out. That you may forgive in your time. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. At this time we have communion. Communion is just one of the fancy words that says that we're getting together with the body of Christ and to acknowledge Jesus as the death, as his death, burial, and resurrection. And so Habakkuk says this. I love this scripture because it can go to the New Testament too. Look at the nations and watch and be utterly amazed, for I'm going to do something in your days that you would not believe, even if you were told. Anybody before the cross, if you would have said, oh, he's going to come as a baby in a manger, be innocent and sinless, and then take all the sins of the world on him, and then come back to life in 3 days, you probably would have been thought crazy, right? You probably would have been kicked out of the synagogue. You probably would have been stoned to death. How dare you? God is righteous and he's the judge and he's powerful and he's almighty. He's not going to come as a baby in a smelly manger. But he did. He was tempted in every way. And yet he went to the cross, sinless, and became sin for us. And so we acknowledge in communion every Sunday that he is the Savior of the world. He is our God. And we worship and adore him no matter what's going on in this world. Let's pray. God, thank you for this time that we can come around the table to acknowledge you and to say thank you for your death, burial, and resurrection, that we may start the week knowing and pointing ourselves and our minds and our spirits towards Jesus Christ. Thank you for the body of Christ that we are together as one, and we can take this together. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. As we pass out the cup and the bread, please hold that until the end of the song, and then we'll take it together as the church. In the name of Jesus, let's partake. Stand together. If you want to have a relationship with Jesus Christ and you want to have that close relationship that you could just, you know, pray anything to God and that you have that friendship, you need to come through Jesus. And so if you want to have a relationship, you need to put your faith in Jesus first. Because he came, he died, he rose, he ascended, and guess what? He's coming back, people. Okay? And so you need to have faith in Jesus. And that faith moves us to repent and to confess our sins and be immersed into water and to walk with him through our days. And so I encourage you to put faith in Jesus. And we can help you with that. The Bible teaches it. You can do that with Jesus in your private time. Whatever you want to do, put your faith in Jesus. He is the one who loves us and takes care of us. And he's the watchman. He watches over us. So let him do it instead of us doing all of it. Let him do it. He's awesome, and he can see things further out than us. And so put your faith in Jesus. So we're going to sing together the doxology, and then I'll pray, and then we'll go home, and you can eat. Okay, here we go. It will come on. It's just a delay.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
So much for this day. God, thank you for start off the week, and God, thank you for our family in Christ. I pray that we will pray like Habakkuk and just trust in your timing, that you are the watchman of our souls. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Have a great week.